Welcome to the local storage session. In this session, we'd like to discuss a number of online and offline interaction patterns. And here we'll be focusing a little bit on the offline interaction pattern because that is where we would need local storage. And inside of OutSystems 10, local storage entities are going to be able to exist on the device. And they will enable all of our offline and caching scenarios. So for us to be able to have nice offline interaction patterns and design for that type of user experience, we're going to need these local storage entities. Now we can create them relatively easily if they need to duplicate an existing database entity, or we can go ahead and create them from scratch because they may be a mapping of several different types of entities. Once we have local storage entities, we may need to initialize them with some original data. And once they're initialized and ready, depending on whether or not users can update that local storage information and it needs to be reported back, we may need to be able to synchronize the data with the server. So local storage entities are very valuable and very useful. We just have to think a little bit about the different types of things we have to do to work with them appropriately. Now, the last thing that we'll talk about is securing locally stored data. Once we decide that some of the data can exist on the device, we begin to create another type of security problem, and we want at least to be aware of the opportunities or risks that are there, and we want to make sure that we have a couple ways of securing the data that is stored locally. So let's get started talking about these topics. If we think about the typical interaction patterns, if we were creating something like our to-do list, and we just wanted to store everything on the server, then our aggregate that's going to fetch data will fetch the data from the RESTful endpoint. It'll make the call to the server will get the information and send it back, and then we'll be able to render to-dos in the list and be able to work with them. But if we want them to be local and not actually come off of the server, then we might have to change that to be able to say, okay, we'll get some set of to-dos to start with, and then from there on those to-dos will be stored in local storage, and we'll retrieve all the to-dos from local storage, and when we make updates or changes, they'll be updated or changed in local storage. And if we need to synchronize, maybe sometime later, we would go ahead and synchronize them. But the difference here is the regular interaction stores things in the database on the server, and here we'd be storing things locally on the device. And in a number of cases, the storage can be different, but it's usually something like SQLite. So when we talk about local storage, we have the capability of creating local storage entities, and those are the entities that are going to enable our offline scenarios. They are stored on the device, so we have the capability of fetching them anytime. It doesn't matter if we're online or offline, we will have access to the data because it is there. Now, there are actually a number of different use cases to use local storage. We continually think of offline because that's the major type of interaction that is difficult to do without local storage. But once we have local storage, because you have the capability of storing data locally, you can create your own standalone app that doesn't ever need to talk to the server at all. You can also use local storage as a cache to go ahead and store certain bits of data that rarely change. So why not download it once instead of every time we go and either start the app or close the app, have to go and get that data again. If we store it locally and just check for changes, the caching and the performance of the app could potentially be even faster. And then certainly the big one that we're worried about is the offline use case. So the offline use case will use local storage entities to store the data locally, and then we'll begin making choices as to should the data stored locally be read-only or can it be changed? Will it be all of the data or will it be a subset of the data? And we'll begin to answer a number of those questions depending on the type of app and the design that we're worried about. Now when we begin to think about the details of local storage entities in OutSystems, we already mentioned they're stored on the device, but they can also be created from database entities. So when we look at the database entities, there's a set of them, and then if we come to the local storage entities, we can ask it to add an entity from the database. And that will basically duplicate the database entity and create a local copy of that. So if we had to-dos, they would be called local to-dos, and they would have the exact same set of attributes as the ones in the database. So it matches the entity directly, and that would make it much easier for us to map the syncing process. Now, one thing that is a little strange for the local storage entities, if you've worked with out systems before, you may know that we have the capability of previewing data from database entities, and that we can bootstrap. So there's an advanced capability where we can sort of initialize and bootstrap the database entity with some information from an Excel spreadsheet. Local storage entities don't have either of those available. And the reason we can't say view the data is because when we're in the development environment working, we're actually talking to the OutSystem server. And the OutSystem server can't talk back to the device and the local storage in the device to be able to give you what is the data in the device itself. And in the same way, without sort of basically bootstrapping some sort of database information and then transferring it to local storage, there's no way we can go ahead and create a set of actions that will directly run on the device and automatically create local storage there. So these two things that you may be accustomed to kind of help us get started with development and have some data that we can work with, those are not going to be available directly on local storage entities. And this brings us to the fact that we'll need to initialize the local storage. And sometimes just having the local storage types is good enough because the user will be creating all of the data. They're the ones that generate the data and will keep updating the data because the data is theirs, it's personal, and all of it is available. Many times we'll need some set of data for an app that comes from the server because the application has more information and data that isn't user specific or maybe team specific, because what we're really talking about here is potentially a number of users having devices and access to an application that has distributed data where people are sharing information. So we would need to originally initialize local storage if it needs to have some sort of initial set of data. So when we think about initializing local storage, we can have a synchronization button, and the synchronization could always say, hey, we're just going to synchronize the data the same way every time. So it's basically an initialization itself. If not, there may be some way that we have to initialize data, and we can either do that as a single configuration step, or sometimes we can just create that as part of the install process for the application. So there are a couple choices as to how we can go ahead and approach that, but just as an example here, let's say we decided to create a button like download data to local storage that would allow us to initialize and get everything from the server. So our download data on click for this button would then need to trigger the offline data sync. And triggering offline data sync calls the client action offline data sync, and the offline data the offline data sync client action calls the server data sync server action. And then inside that server data sync, we may have a number of different ways to do synchronization. In this particular case, because we're initializing it, we'd want to get all of the data that we need from the server to initialize local storage. So we might make a call that says get all data, and when get all data is called, then it will go ahead and get all of the data and then return it. So in this particular case, the server data sync will make the call, the get all data will be run, and then we'll get the information back, and we'll have initial local storage done. So initializing local storage will use part of the data synchronization framework, and we're going to talk about that framework a lot more in one of the next sessions. Now, once we have our local storage initialized, then after that point we can make the decision as to whether or not, you know, if we're offline we'll update local storage, or if we're online we might make calls to the server. So it becomes more of a design capability once we know we can get to local storage, store some of the information there, and it may already have data that we need initialized. So once all the data is here, at different times we may choose to synchronize. We may say, hey, whenever I open the app after it's been closed, I'd like it to go ahead and synchronize the data. So we can have background processes, and again, part of a synchronization framework, worrying about things like synchronizing on login, synchronizing on resume, synchronize when we open the app. And depending on what we need, that synchronization may be different, because depending on what type of scenario we're thinking about, the synchronization may be all of the data or part of the data. So we're never quite sure what the server is going to do when we synchronize. There may be different choices that are available. Now, that gets us a good introduction to local storage. We understand that we can create different types of entities and that we may need to initialize and then worry about synchronization. But this does mean that local storage entities will be locally stored on the device. And in general, from a security standpoint, it's probably a best practice to say we should avoid storing sensitive data on the device. Devices can be lost or stolen, and that creates risk of people being able to get to that type of data. So during our design, we should really think about having the minimum subset of data to allow the key offline tasks that we need, but not store any more sensitive data than that. If we do that, what are the different ways we could secure that sensitive data? Well, if we have very small amounts of sensitive data, you can actually use the device's key store or keychain, and you can go ahead and store small bits of data in that. And that's something that's available on the device, and it's available all of the time. To be able to use that, we need the key store plugin from the Forge, but we'd be able to go ahead and store small bits of information there, and that's managed by the device and the operating system itself. The other way we could store small amounts of data is using JavaScript encryption. So we could get a JavaScript encryption framework and say that before we store the data, we'll go ahead and encrypt it. And then when we need to retrieve the data, we'll decrypt it after we retrieve it, and then we'll have that sensitive data there. Now, one problem that that sort of generates is that if we're using an encryption framework, there's probably some sort of encryption key, and we need to secure that somewhere to make sure that this encryption and decryption is done safely. A lot of times the encryption key is actually stored in the key store or the keychain. So sometimes you'll use both of these capabilities together to store certain bits of data. What if my application has mostly sensitive data and I still need to be able to keep them safe and want to do all that? So storing large amounts of sensitive data, you can go ahead and encrypt all of the local storage. And to be able to do that, you can use the ciphered local storage plugin, and that will help you do that. So everything in local storage will be encrypted, but obviously to do that, there is a performance overhead. So every time we read data and every time we write data, it's going to have to be encrypted. So all of those data operations may see a performance hit. But that's the trade-off for us making sure that we have sensitive data completely secure on the device. So, a number of different scenarios, a number of different ways to worry about having local storage if that data is sensitive, and we'd like to try to avoid that as much as possible. We do have the capability of going ahead and securing it. So using these plugins is a key way to go ahead and make local data more secure. So, in this session, we talked about local storage, and we looked at how online and offline patterns are a little different. Local storage entities will enable us to have these offline interaction patterns that we want. The local storage is on the device. It can be created quickly and easily from the database entities that we've created, and we may need to initialize and synchronize that data over time. And we want to be very careful about the types of data that we put on the device. We need to be able to secure that data, and that's very important. So hopefully this gives you a good idea of what local storage makes available to us, and the next section we're going to talk about is how to synchronize some of this data that ends up in local storage.